فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
The third one is قرينة في الراوي. There's an indication to show that the hadith is made up. Such as what? The man is a rafidi. He is a rafidi, khabith. So what happens is that the hadith is in the virtue of Ahlul Bayt Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The scholars, they tend to realize that this man is making it up. And it hasn't come to us except from him. It's never come to us except through him. He's a rafidi. Huh? And then again, it's regarding the virtue of Ahlul Bayt. That's a sign. That's a qarina. The last one, which is qarinatu fil marwi. That one was a qarinatu fil rawi, an indication to the narrator. The last one is an indication to the narration, which is that the hadith is very, the wordings are very, very, as the Arabs will call it, rakikul laf. The wordings are very hard. Like the usage of the wordings are very hard. Huh? Or it goes against his, things that are tangible. That man, that's not right, that doesn't make sense. It goes against logic as well. Or it goes against the sarihul Qur'an, it goes against the kirika of the Qur'an. Or it goes against unanimous agreed upon qawa'id, which the scholars agree upon. It goes against it. This is a qarina, because it's impossible. A hadith which is sahih will go against the fitratus, the aql which is sarih. And it'll go against the aql. What causes a wadda' to place a hadith? What causes a person to fabricate a hadith? What causes it? The first one is at-taqarrubu ila Allah ta'ala. He tries to get closer to Allah. He wants to get closer to Allah. بِوَضْعِ الْأَحَادِيثِ الْحَدِيثِ تَرْغِيبًا لِلنَّاسِ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ. He wants to urge the people in the good. وَتَرْهِيبًا بِفِعْلِ الْمُنْكَرَاتِ. And he wants to put fear in the people from the evil. And that's, the scholars, they call these people, Alhamdulillah, this is the majority of the time, هَؤُلَا يُنْسَبُونَ إِلَى الزُّهْدِ وَالصَّلَاحِ. They're the Ahlul Zuhd. Salah. It's those people. وَهُمْ, and the scholars, they say, وَهُمْ شَرُّ أَنْوَاعِ الْوَضَّاعِينَ. They are the worst of places of hadith, those ones, Ahlul Zuhd. And Ahlul Salah. People get fooled with them in it. They see them praying a lot. They see them fasting. They see a lot of righteousness in them. So when they place a hadith, people cannot, they won't think it's wrong. It's a weak, a fabricated hadith. And from those people, because the people, لَقَبُولِ النَّاسِ مَوْضُعَاتِهِمْ ثِقَّةٌ بِهِمْ. Because the people rely a lot on them. From those people was who the man I mentioned before, Abu Usbah al-Nuh ibn Abi Maryam. He's a Zahid, he was a Zahid. And look at him, what he did was, he placed a virtue for every ayah, surah in the Qur'an, trying to urge the people to read the Qur'an, and to benefit from the Qur'an. That's why he did it. He wanted to get closer to Allah through it. Number two, قَصْدُ الْوَاضِعِ إِفْسَادُ الدِّينِ. The second one is, he does it to do what? إِفْسَادُ الدِّينِ. He wants to bring corruption to the religion. He's actually trying to, زَنَادِقَ. زَنَادِقَ, they're called. Which are people who want to cause corruption in the religion of Islam. عَلَى أَهْلِ وَالتَّشْكِيكُمْ فِيهِ. And they want to open thought and assumptions and speculate in the people's hearts towards Islam. Like the man, Abdul Karim ibn Abi al-Awja. Abdul Karim ibn Abi al-Awja and Muhammad ibn Sa'id al-Maslub. They were known. Abdul Karim ibn Abi al-Awja was the man who got slaughtered because of the fact that he placed a hadith. But alhamdulillah, scholars like Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn al-Dukayn, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, Abdurrahman ibn Mahdi, Ahmed ibn Hanbal, Ishaq ibn Rawi, Yahya ibn Ma'in, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, Sufyan al-Thawri, ibn Jurayj, Ma'am ibn Rashid, Abdul Razak ibn Hamam al-Sana'ali. A'imma al-Nuqad came, they worked on the hadith. Got rid of all of those fabricated hadith. The third reason would be al-intisaru lil-madhhab, lil-madhahib. The person is doing it because he ascribes to a particular madhhab or a particular group. Even these madhahibs, the Ahnaf and the Malikiyah and the Shafi'iyah and the Hanabila, they make a hadith for their madhabs. Some used to ascribe hadith to the Prophet. They'll say that, مَنْ لَمْ يَتَشَفَّعْ. Anyone who doesn't become a Shafi'i. This would happen to him, Allah will curse him. People make a hadith for their madhabs, forcing people to come to it. Especially the ones who were worse at that, وَأَهْلُ الْأَهْوَاءِ وَالْبِدَعْ. People of innovation. They would make up hadith نُصْرَةً لِمَذَاهِبِهِمْ, trying to give victory to their madhabs. و ولذلك one of the innovators who Allah guided him to Sunnah, who left his innovation, he used to say, he said to the people when he repented, as Imam al-Arram al-Hurmuzi mentioned in his kitab al-Muhaddith al-Fasil, and Ibn Hibban mentioned in his kitab al-Majruhin, he said to the people after he repented, he said, انظروا هذا الحديث. Look at these narrations that are being brought to you, O people. ممن تأخذون, from the people you guys are taking it from. فَإِنَّا كُنَّا وِوَا إِذَا رَأَيْنَا رَأْيًا, if we saw a view, جَعَلْنَا لَهُ حَدِيثًا, we would make a narration for it. That's how we were. If we thought and we had a view in a matter, we would make a hadith for it. Number four, the cause that would make people to place a hadith or make it up is الرغبة في التكسب. الرغبة في التكسب. التكسب. The person will do it because he wants money. He wants provision. He wants risk. Money, money, money. So make up a hadith. Like the Qusas storytellers. Storytellers who tell the people stories and they want to come with something very amazing that no one's ever said it. And they're storytellers. Nowadays, there are a lot of storytellers who go around universities, who go to places where they give talks. And I think Muhammad ibn Sirin used to say, instead of listening to a storyteller tell us a story, I prefer doing nabtul ibt. I prefer picking my armpits than listen to a storyteller. I prefer doing that. Going and just doing my armpits instead of listening to a storyteller tell a story all day. And that's when you realize Muslims just love stories. All day he wants stories. Ahkam, rulings, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, evidence is being extracted from the Quran and the Sunnah, people start to go to sleep. When you tell the people stories, oh, everyone's awake. And that's the reason, is because of what we watched when we were young. Cartoons, story time, this and that. People watched it. So what was it? Story. Everything story. When they go to sleep, the kids want stories. Stories, stories, stories. So the storytellers, that's how they're like. They will like to make hadith. يَسْتَمِعُ النَّاسِ إِلَيْهِمْ, so the people can hear these stories. وَيُعْطُوهُمْ, and so when the people hear these stories, like, wow. And then the people pay. They give you money. That's why. وَقَدْ اشْتَهَرَ بِذَلِكَ جَمَاعَةٌ, a group of people became famous for this. Abu Sa'id al-Ma'ini. Madaini, sorry. Abu Sa'id al-Madaini was very famous for that. He was a storyteller, and he would make up narrations for it. The fifth one is قَصْدُ الْوَاضِعَ التَّزَلُّفُ إِلَى الْخُلَفَاء. A person will want to get closer to the rulers. It's called at-tazallufu. The person, at-tazallufu, he wants to get closer to the rulers, so he makes a hadith for them. Hypocrisy and just, you know, give them a hadith, and so the rulers can call him into their gatherings, and then they give them money. And from them was the famous Ghiyath ibn Ibrahim al-Nakhai al-Kufi, who one time entered upon the Amir al-Mu'mineen al-Mahdi. He entered him one time. حين دخل عليه وهو يلعب بالحمام. And the ruler was playing with a bird, a pigeon. And so when he saw him play with a pigeon, he made a hadith straight away. The hadith already exists, but he added additional to it, أو جناحين, anyone who plays with a pigeon. So he made a hadith for him. Added that particular part, which is that the Prophet ﷺ has said it. Mahdi rahimahullah was a great scholar, a great man of knowledge. When he realized what he did and he understood, he said to the people, slaughter the sheep, slaughter the pigeon. He said, slaughter the throat of this pigeon. When he stood, and then he looked at him and he said to him, I hamaltu ala dhalika. I'm the one who forced this man into that view, which is Ghiyath ibn Ibrahim. Watarada, and he kicked him out of his place. He said, Mahdi, he said, take him out of my house. Don't let this man stay with me. And he got opposite to what he was looking for. He got opposite to what he was looking for. So that's what would cause people to make hadith. The last one, which is قصد الواضع الشهرة ومحبة الظهور. The person wants to become famous. He wants to be very famous. And he likes this fame that comes with it. He likes this fame that comes with it. So, because he wants the people to be amazed with the narrations that he has and how short they are, and so people come to him and they'll be amazed and they want to hear these things from him. Those are the ones that intended. Those are the ones what? Who actually intended what? Who actually intended? Who actually intended to place a hadith. But there are some people who didn't intend. They didn't intend it. but they made up hadith. And they are these people. Those ones, they say, the scholars, غَالَبَةُ الزُّهْدِ وَالْعِبَادِ عَلَى بَعْضِ النَّاسِ حَتَّى جَعَلَتْهُمْ يَغَفِلُونَ عَنِ الْحِفْدِ وَالتَّمَيُّزِ حَتَّى صَارَ الطَّابِعُ لِكَثِيرٍ مِنِ الزُّهَدِ الْغَفْلَةِ. He became so heedless because he was so focused on ibadah and so focused on being aesthetic. He became heedless and his memory became bad and he couldn't distinguish in between anything. So everything was getting mixed up. And so the hadith were becoming fabricated as though it was made up. It was as though it was made up. Had no basis whatsoever. Okay? The second one is Diya'u al-Kutub. The person who wrote his hadith will not look after his book. Inshallah, later we're going to take, when we come to the matters pertaining to writing a hadith and how the person, the conditions the ulama put regarding the one who wrote the hadith, if he wants to narrate from his book. So the second one is that Diya'u al-Kitab, Kutub. He forsakes his book. He puts it on a shelf. He puts it somewhere everybody can get. Or ihtiraqiha, or his books get burnt. Mimi i'tamudu bih. ثم بعد ذلك يحدث من حفظي. And then starts to try to narrate from his memory. Or the one whose book was, and he put it in a place where everybody can get. People of evil started to get his books and they added things to it. They added things to his book, or they reduced things from his book, and he wouldn't know, so he would narrate. From the people whose books got burnt, and who started to try to narrate before, and try to narrate from his memory, when he used to narrate from his books, was Abdullah ibn Lahi'a. Scholars, they say that he used to narrate from a book. And what had happened is his book got burnt. His book got burnt. So he tried to read it from his memory. And scholars chose not to narrate from him. The scholars know who he narrated from before his books got burnt. They take his hadith. Such as if he narrates from Abdullah ibn Mubarak. Abdullah ibn Mubarak narrated from him, sorry. When Abdullah ibn Mubarak narrated from him, Abdullah ibn Wahb, Abdullah ibn Zayd, Qutaybah ibn Sa'id and others were numbered, when they narrated from him, his hadith are taken. After that, scholars chose not to take it from him. Na'am. What are the things that made an hadith which are fabricated to spread? What are the causes that allowed a hadith which are fabricated to spread? To be honest, the reason why some of the mufassirin, they mention these ahadiths which are fabricated in their books of tafsir. And it's a very bad mistake to narrate these kind of ahadith. La siyama, especially the narration of Ubay ibn Ka'ab in the fada'il, the virtues of every, the Qur'an, surah and surah, and Ibn Abbas's ones that people narrate. From those who do it is Tha'labi. Tha'labi, he would narrate manakir, mawdu'at in his books. You see Al-Wahidi, he does it. Al-Zamakhshari, Al-Baydawi, and Al-Shawkani. They all narrate ahadith which are mawdu'at. The books that have been written regarding ahadith which are fabricated, scholars have written books. From those books are Kitab al-Mawdu'at Ibn al-Jawzi. And it's one of the earliest books that have been written regarding fabricated narrations. In this book. But if you look at it, he's very lean in that book. Mutasahil. في الحكم على الحديث, when putting rulings on the hadith, placing rulings on the hadith which are fabricated. So for that reason, scholars have criticized him and refuted him in that. There's another book written by Suyuti rahimahullah, it's called Al-Ali al-Masnu'atu fi al-Ahadith al-Mawdu'a. It's an abridged version of Ibn al-Jawzi's book. And he mentioned some things that Ibn al-Jawzi didn't mention. So he mentioned that. There's also the kitab تنزيه الشريعة المرفوعة عن الأحاديث الشريعة الموضوعة لابن عراق الكناني, and it's an abridged book from the previous ones that I mentioned. Like, to be honest and to give you be truthful, the best book that's written regarding hadith which are موضوعة and which are ضعيف is none other than the book of Shaykh Al-Allama Muhammad Nasir al-Din al-Albani رحمه الله. His سلسلة أحاديث الصحيحة سلسلة أحاديث الضعيفة and موضوعة he wrote. And he brings a hadith which are mawdu', fabricated. And Sheikh Nasir, Allah blessed him subhanahu wa ta'ala with something that, you know, you could say that no one preceded him in. Which is, he brings the hadith and he puts a ruling on the hadith by using the science of hadith on it. So he walks you how he came to this conclusion that this hadith is mawdu'. And that was not known before. That was not known prior to Shaykh Al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala. Somebody to do that, all the hadith. People did do it, hadith here and there. But to stand on every hadith and to put a ruling just about every hadith, Shaykh Nasir Allah tabarak wa ta'ala opened that for him. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the Shaykh rahimahullah, he said, وَالثَّانِي. The second one is who? Second one is al-matruk. Matruk is which one? Hey, who remembers? At-ta'aruf al-rawi, at-tuhmatu bil-kadhib. At-tuhmatu bil-kadhib. The one that was suspected of kadhib. What's that hadith called? That hadith is called matruk. Hadith is called matruk. Linguistically, matruk is ismu maf'ul min at-tarki. It's an ism maf'ul from the word tark, to leave off something. To leave off something. The Arabs, they call it. Istilahan means what? هو الحديث الذي في إسناده راو متهم بالكذب. Technically, it means the hadith, which in its chain of narration is a person who is suspected of lying. Who is suspected of lying. أسباب اتهام الراوي بالكذب. What are the reasons why a narrator will be suspected of lying? It's one of two. One of two. And we did mention this before. The first one is what? أَلَّا يُرْوَى ذَلِكَ الْحَدِيثِ إِلَّا مِنْ جِهَتِي. This hadith has not been narrated except through him. وَيَكُونَ مُخَالِفَ لِقَوَاعِدِ الْمَعْلُومَةِ. And this, it goes against the قواعد, the principles which are known. Such as al-bara'atu, al-asru bara'atu dhimma. قواعد like that. It might go against it. Which are general rulings. And it only come through him. The second one is, أَنْ يُعْرَفَ الرَّاوِيُ بِالْكَذِبِ. The narrator is known to lie, but he's only known to lie في كلام العادي, in his day-to-day speech. But he it's never become apparent him lying regarding the hadith of the Messenger, عليه الصلاة والسلام. Example of this is the hadith, which is matruk, is the hadith narrated by Amr ibn Shamiri al-Ju'fi al-Kufi, who narrated from Jabir ibn Abdullah, who narrated عن أبي طفيل عن علي وعمار. Sorry, not Jabir ibn Abdullah, sorry. Amr ibn Shamiri al-Ju'fi al-Kufi عن جابر عن أبي طفيل عن علي وعمار. علي وعمار قالا, they both said, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقنط في الفجر, that the Prophet used to do qunut in Fajr. ويكبر يوم عرفة من صلاة الغداتي, and then the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he would do takbir on يوم عرفة, the day of عرفة, من صلاة الغداتي, from the صلاة الغدات, ظهر onwards. ويقطع صلاة العصر آخر أيام التشريق, and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would disconnect صلاة العصر آخر أيام التشريق, the last days of تشريق. نسائي دار قطني, and other than them, they said Amr ibn Shamiri, he's a matruk al-hadith. When we hear the word matruk al-hadith, what does it mean? Straight away, when you stand over, متهم بالكذب, he's suspected of lying, one way or another. The next one, which is وَالثَّالِثُ الْمُنْكَرُ عَلَى الرَّأْيِ وَكَذَا الرَّابِعُ وَالْخَامِسُ. What was that? What is the third one? الْفُحْشُ الْغَلَطُ. What is the fourth one? كَثْرَةُ الْغَفْلَةِ. And the fifth one was what? الْفِسْقُ. Isn't that right? All three of them are called munkar. Some of you, I remember, I think it was Imran, who said, Ustad, some of them are ضَبْطُ الْعَدَالَةِ, and some are طَعَنُ فِي الْعَدَالَةِ, and another, some are طَعَنُ فِي الْضَبْطِ, صحيح. Some was memory, and some was his reliability. The reason why Ibn Hajar mixed them up is because of this. Because the فُحْشُ الْغَلَطِ, or كَثْرَةِ الْغَفْلَةِ, or الْفِسْقَ, all of the hadith, with those three, when those three are present, that hadith, any of those three, is called مُنْكَرُ الْحَدِيثِ. If it's due to فُحْشُ الْغَلَطِ, or it's due to كَثْرَةُ الْغَفْلَةِ, or it's due to فِسْقَ, that hadith is called what? That hadith is called? It's called مُنْكَر. And what does it mean, an inkar? It's ضد الإقرار. It's the opposite to affirmation. مُنْكَر is something you reject. نَكَارَ is what you don't accept. The opposite to it, الإقرار, is to affirm. You see? That's what it means linguistically. And it's ism maf'ul min al-inkar. And what does it mean technically? It is the hadith. In its chain of narration is a narrator who has fuhshul rawin fahusha ghalatuhu aw kathurat ghaflatuhu aw dhahara fisquhu. It's a narrator in the chain of narration, fahusha ghalatuhu, his ghalat there's a narrator who's fahish al-ghalat, or kathrat ghafla, or he has fisq is apparent. And we took those three last time.